Welcome back to this free Figma course for complete beginners. My name is Ines, I'm a principal product designer and a hiring manager with 15 years of experience. And in this lesson, we're going to learn how to create components and what crucial settings we need to be mindful of. If you've missed the previous lessons of this course, check out my YouTube page and watch them. Now let's first discuss, what do we consider a component in UI design? In a nutshell, a component is a Lego block that we use to build other pages, and we use it in different combinations. We have had a lesson about the UI libraries already, and I recommend you to watch this lesson before you start on this one. You can find it in my YouTube channel for free. The important concept that we discussed last time in the UI library lesson is that a component can be controlled from one place. Meaning that if you have the instances of this component in different pages, you can only change it once in your library and it will be changed in all of the pages, which opens up numerous amazing possibilities for us to increase the speed of our design. Now let's see how you can create a component in Figma. Let's imagine that you have designed a button, but right now this button is done with auto layouts. We already had a lesson on auto layouts as well. And right now, if you copy paste the button and you make a change in the initial instance of this button, nothing will change here in the second instance. It is because this button is not a component yet. For it to be a component, you need to set it so. You can do that from many places of Figma interface. The easiest one is to right-click and create a component from here, or by using a shortcut that you can see on the screen. I also like to use this panel on the right-hand side because it has a lot of handy settings that one can apply to a frame. And now let's create a component from here, and you can see that it is now highlighted by purple, and in the layers section, you might notice that there is a new icon that is now set together with this frame. This icon indicates that we have a main component created. So you can see the difference right away. This is how this icon will look if this is an instance of a component. Let's first see how the instance will behave then if we change the main component. So if we change a name, say to add to favorite, you will notice that everything will be duplicated in the instance. One thing to mention here is that if you change something in an instance, it will not be changed in a main component. You can actually push it to your main component, and we're going to see how, but first, if you accidentally changed your instance and this is not something that you want, you can just reset all changes. Now, how can you push your changes to a main component? In a new Figma interface, you can do that with this panel. And this is the reason I love this panel so much, because it contains now all the main actions one can do with a component. And this is what you see here, push changes to main component. So let's do that. And now you can see that all changes we made in an instance are now the default of our main component. You can also detach an instance from a main component and they will not be connected anymore. And there will be no way to connect them together. To do that, trigger the right-hand side menu and detach the instance or use the shortcut here. So see, now it is not even highlighted by purple because it is just a frame with no components attached to it, with not being an instance of anything. Now, this is the superpower of the components and the reason why we love them so much in Figma. They speed up our work significantly, and I definitely recommend you spending time and mastering this part of Figma. Components together with auto layouts are our bread and butter in UI design. But actually, components are a much deeper topic. If you are a beginner and what I have shown to you right now is a completely new information, then maybe make a pause here, go to your Figma files, try out the ways of creating the main components and the instances that I have shown to you, because this will be something that you're going to work with 90% of your time. The next functions I'm going to show are a bit more advanced, but they are really, really necessary because the projects we are designing for are getting bigger and bigger, and the UI design itself is getting more and more mature every year. So it's really crucial that you master components on the advanced level. But before we go, if you like this lesson and you plan to continue learning Figma, hit the subscribe button down below and click the bell. This way you will get notified when a new lesson comes out. Let's go and review the advanced functions of components. First, you might know that in UI design, we usually don't have just one button. Because a button itself as a component, it has different states. We can hover on a button and it's going to be highlighted, it can be disabled, it can be in a default state. All those sorts of options we have to design for each and every interface that we are creating. And the components can handle this use case for us. Let's review this example. We have two states for a button, a default state and a disabled state, when we cannot click on it. We have to tick a box, for example, somewhere in the interface to make this button work. The first button is the main component. The second one is an instance. So how can we combine them together so Figma knows that those are two different states of the same component? There are actually multiple ways on how you can do that. I prefer to turn an instance into a main component as well, and then combine them as variants. Now you see what has happened. They are visually combined with this purple dotted line to indicate they are the states of a same component. They are variants. And let's review what has changed in the layers panel. Now we have only one component that is called component 4. Maybe let's call it button. The names are also not very nice, so let's make them logical. And the second one will be called disabled. And you can see actually that I'm not changing the first part of the equation. The property 1 disabled, this is where I changed only the second part. If I delete the first part of the equation, you see that the Figma will not be happy about that. It will show us that the layer has an invalid name, so you have to be mindful not to delete this first part and always have this property 1 as the first part of the equation in place. There is a second way how you can change a name if you don't want to mess out with these properties, if you don't want to delete something that is wrong. You can easily do it here. This is probably a more friendly way. So here the property 1 stays in place, we're not changing it, and only for the second part we will change that this is a default button. Looks amazing, but let's not forget that we are still editing a main component. It's time to review what will change for us if we are working with the instances of this component. Let's create an instance first. Oh yeah, by the way, it's not the way how you can create an instance. This way you will create another variant. Oops, this is also not what I want. By the way, this is a bit of a weird way how you can create an instance from a group of components that are combined as variants. You see what I'm doing in here? I'm scrolling a bit away from the initial group to be able to pass this as an instance. Otherwise, it will always be added as a variant. This is a bit of a weird thing in Figma, and maybe there is a more elegant way to do that. Frankly, I don't usually copy a main component so that to add it as an instance to my board, I use the assets panel on the left hand side, because here I just have all the components and it's really easy to navigate it and to find the one that I need. But anyways, let's get back to the instance that we have created and let's review what the property 1 is changing for us. It changes the default and the disabled view for us just through a simple click, which is really amazing, and it really speeds up our work. By the way, if you don't like that it is called property 1, you can also easily change it, say to state. And now in our instance, we have it called state. Awesome. And this is something that you are going to use most of the time. The variants are very handy. And since they are introduced in Figma, this is honestly something that I use every day. And when I am about to create a component, I am immediately thinking about the instances that are going to be associated with it. I recommend you having a look into variants because the use cases that you can handle with them are numerous. But this is not yet everything. Let's go further. Let's imagine that you have a button with an icon. And you might want to sometimes hide an icon and sometimes make it visible. You can actually go multiple ways. You can just create a simple instance and delete the icon. This way it will be hidden in your layers, but you can always switch it on. It will not be deleted because it is just hidden and it will stay in the main component. This is the option number one. The option number two is that you can create a variant and the second variant will not have an icon. So this way you can combine them as variants and do the same as we did with naming properties and just calling it icon yes, no. But there is a more elegant way in how you can handle this use case in Figma. So let's delete it. This alternative way is called Boolean property. And Boolean basically means a toggle. You can even see that it is visualized as a toggle icon here. So we can create a Boolean named icon. And icon can be switched on and switched off. It could only have a true or false value. So let's set it to true. We create this property. But right now, unfortunately, Figma does not know with which element inside of a component this property is associated with. Because you might have two icons and you might want to have a toggle for all of them, for both of them. So you need to manually attach this property to the element that you wanted to be handling. And I'm doing this by choosing first the icon and then going to the appearance panel. And yes, it is not very explicit how it is done in Figma, but it is also a bit of a more advanced and elegant way how you can handle variants and states in Figma. Again, if you are lost, you can use variants or you can just copy instances and hide some layers within it. But if you will select this icon in the appearance panel and will choose the property icon, this is what is going to happen when you are working with your instance. In the instance right now, you can see that I can have a toggle that switch on and switch off my icon. And you know, when you're working with the complex design libraries, where every instance have like 10, 5 properties that you need to manage in order to choose the right state that you want, having it sometimes managed through a toggle and not as a drop down can really save you time. Yes, I know it's just one click and you can in theory create a drop down with the icon yes or icon no. But again, as I said, it is a bit more advanced and if you are lost here, it's completely fine. It will come in time and just focus on practicing variants and initial main components and instances. But it's not yet it, and we're going to the next use case. And in this use case, you might have a set of icons that you want to be used in a button. You can encounter this use case in a very realistic scenario, actually, when your design library consists of 100, 200 icons, but you want to limit people from choosing any icon that they want to be used in a button, because it either does not make sense to use the rest of them, and also you want to speed up the work of your colleagues, your own work, by allowing to choose from a predefined set of icons, from the preferred icons. Let's see how you can do that. Right now, we again have a main component here, and there are two icons that are also main components. In the main component, we can add a property called instance swap. Let's call it icon and let's pick a value that are going to be our default one. In this case, this is going to be our heart. Next, we're going to choose the preferred values, meaning that we're going to indicate which icons we recommend users to use in this component. In this case, there are only two icons, I choose them all. And we create this property. Now, a very important thing, same as with the previous use case, Figma does not yet know which icon do you mean actually. This is a bit dumb in my opinion because I have indicated which one I mean, but anyways, right now it is done in a way that you have to manually assign this property to the element that you want to be swapped. In this scenario, again, I'm choosing my icon, and this time I'm going here in this right-hand side panel and apply instance swap property by triggering this icon. And I have only one property indicated here, and it is icon. When I create an instance, a copy of my main component, you can see that I have a property here called icon, and I can choose right away from the icon that I indicated as recommended options. I can actually choose anything in the file and place it here. It is not limiting me from doing this, but it is really handy that I have this preferred icons option, and it saves me time while designing. But anyways, there are other ways how you can do that. You can hide multiple icons inside of your component. It's not very elegant, but you can then hide the icons that you don't need, or you can create variants. But this way is just a bit more elegant and a bit easy to work with. And the other handy thing is that you can now swap the instance very intuitively if you just select an icon inside of an instance. You don't really need to select the whole component and then predefine it here. So sometimes I find it's more convenient when I see what is selected and then I just change the selection. Now it's time to discuss the last property type that you can assign to a component. It is called text. The idea is that you can treat text the same way as you would treat icons. You will have a library of your UI copy, and then you can use them in different parts of your interface with the possibility to control all this copy from one place. And if you would need to change a copy in your designs, you only change them once in one place in this UI text library. I must say that we are not using that extensively in my work. Also because it was introduced quite recently and our design library was not created yesterday and we did not plan for it in advance. And right now for us to attach all the text instances from different files that we have into one place are going to cost us some time and money. That's why we're not using that, but in theory, it is very handy and modern design systems should be, I think, created with this possibility in mind. One important thing about that in order to treat your copy as a component, you need to create a variable. And variables are going to be covered in the next lessons. So right now, let's not spend the time on the variables. And I will just explain to you that I have already created some variables for my example. Right now I have these two phrases, like and add to favorite. And I want this text to be used in my buttons and I don't want to manually type them down every time I'm creating a button. Here is the possibility for it. You can create a property called text. See, let's call it CTA. And we can add a value right here, and this way we will create a variable. But since I already have some of them created, I can just pick one. Let's choose this one, and I am creating the property. Same way as with previous examples, Figma does not know which text do we mean. So I'm clicking here and I'm selecting the property that I have just created. It is here in purple. This is the CTA. And now the text in my button is defined through the property. Now let's see what's gonna happen if I create an instance of this component. Right now, I will have here a property called CTA from which I can choose the text that predefined in my library. So that was this last property. And as I said, it is a bit more advanced. It will potentially speed up your work and the work of your colleagues within the design library and will reduce the number of potential typos that one can have in their designs. And also if you had an internal discussion about changing the name of a button, you can not be stressed about that because you know that there is one place so you can change it and it will be changed everywhere. Because otherwise you will have to go through all of your design files and to change it manually, which is a lot of work. So it is handy to know this use case, and once we will get to the variables, you will start seeing a bigger picture and you will start enjoying the internal elegancy of Figma in the way how it works with properties and variables and the components. I hope you liked this lesson and now you know how to create components and how to define its properties. If you want to continue mastering Figma, click the subscribe button down below and hit the bell. This way you will be notified when a new lesson comes out. And I see you in the next lesson.